العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا مولانا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala once again for having enabled us to complete yet another day of fast. We pray for acceptance and we thank Him as well for having enabled us to complete yet another night of Taraweeh. We pray for sincerity and steadfastness for the way ahead. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam welcomed various delegations. And on one occasion, there was a delegation that came to him from the southern part of the peninsula. And a huge tribe. The head of this tribe had a nickname, Al-Ash'ath ibn Qais. They accepted Islam, all of them. Al-Ash'ath means the one who's a bit disheveled. His hair was a bit ruly, so they call. But his name was Ma'di Karib, radiallahu anhu. And they took shahada and they pledged allegiance to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his support, etc. But he also informed Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that they had to return. So they spent a few weeks in Medina, learning. He was learning as much as he could from the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and also drawing some guidelines as to how he should handle his people back home. But amongst the group, there was one youngster. They don't mention his name, radiallahu anhu. And this Ma'di Karib noticed that this youngster was not wasting time in playing. Rather, he was going from one sahabi to the next sahabi, learning all that he could of the Quran, memorizing and reciting and rectifying and checking. Now, from the one to the next for those few weeks, to the extent that when they left, the time came for them to leave, and they were on their return journey, they then had to stop for their first salah alone, because they were almost now led by the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Medina. But now, so they learned all that had to be done, and now they're on their way back. And this Ash'ath, Ma'di Karib is his name, he looks around for who? For that youngster to lead them in salah. You with me? And of the other men of the clan, they said, but why him? Why are you sending him forward? And he said a beautiful phrase, which is what we want to come to. Al-Ash'ath ibn Qais, he said, مَا قَدَّمْتُهُ وَلَكِنْ قَدَّمَهُ الْقُرْآنُ. I did not send him forward. It is but the Qur'an that sends him forward. So in that context, but in the broader meaning as well, this young boy that led us tonight, he's about 14, he's completely hafiz. Alhamdulillah. He left now because he's writing an exam tomorrow, his last paper. And he may come tomorrow night again, inshallah. And his father led witr. His father doesn't normally lead, but I thought, they left now, so I can say this. I thought just to honor him, you know why? Besides father and son, okay, but there's something else. Now, before I tell you, bear with me. Are you with me, Sultan? Bear with me. Go back more than 200 years and you look at that print of the Quran there in the beautiful case there with the light hand written by Tuanguru. Abdullah ibn Qadi Abdus Salam, may Allah increase the nur in his qabr. He had many students. He was 60 years old when the Dutch brought him here as a political prisoner. 60! They kept him on Robben Island for 13 years, sir. When they released him, he was 73 years old. Then the man not only had the strength of Iman, but they had the strength of mind and body as well, because at 73 he got married, sir. Yes. And he had two sons, okay? Abdul Raqib and Abdul Ra'uf. Anyway, heathens started preaching Islam at that age, and they may have allowed him to do what he wanted to because he was an elderly man. Maybe they feared nothing from him. But the man was strong, and the man was on a mission, and the man could have relaxed far away from his family, separated from his family. He could have, and he just came from prison. He could have said, okay, I paid my dues. But no, he made da'wah to Islam. And there was a time when he had more than 300 students here under him. And that space there with the middle pillar. The middle pillar is, yeah, that's where the first mihrab was. But before we get there, they were looking for a space. And then he had Jumu'ah out in the stone quarry in Kapini Street. And the authorities said, no, we're not going to silence this man. Give him what he wants. What do you want? He said, I want the right to designate a place, a space for worship. You cannot claim the space. You can't own it. Neither do we claim it. It is waqaf lillah, only for worship. They said, okay, do you have any place in mind? So one of his students and a close friend of his by the name of Ahmed was married to a woman. We don't have record of her Muslim name, but it's okay if she never changed the name. But she was Muslim. She was also a student of Twanguru. What was her name? Sarki van de Kaap. Right? Her father was something of Ceylon. You must check the history. But her husband was Ahmed van Bengalen. You with me? Yeah. He was Twanguru's close friend and a senior student, learned Quran from him, learned belief from him, learned the fiqh from him, and he became known during Twanguru's life. He also became known as an imam. You with me? Sarki and Ahmed, the property was in Sarki's name and her family's name. They donated that piece of property there. And it, we have the document which she has written. She has donated this to the Muhammadan Gemeenskap. Yeah, yes. You with me? But why am I telling you this? Allah linked them through deen those days. Allah linked them and honored the students, because what happened? Ahmed van Bengalen could have just gone past in history, not known. But when Twanguru passed away, you know who was unanimously chosen to lead and become the imam of the Awal Masjid after Twanguru? Ahmed van Bengalen. Now, why am I telling you this? The Quran honored him. Deen honored him. But this boy and his father are descendants of Ahmed van Bengalen. And if we get an opportunity to ask that boy his name, he'll say Tamim Hamza. But if you ask him, tell me your full name, then he'll tell you his name with all the forefathers up until Ahmed van Bengalen. They honor the history. And it's a unique history. It's to be proud of. Alhamdulillah. But, so two things. History and just the link and attachment to the masjid. They love the masjid. And this man, the father, never got an opportunity to lead any time here. Must have been nice for him. Make dua. But the boy, yes, inshallah. The issue is what? Quran. Quran, have a young child lead us in prayer unanimously. Bowing, then we bow after him. Prostrating, we prostrate after him. He leads us in prayer to the Creator. What granted him that honor? Any degree? Any ownership of anything? Any other titles besides that of a companion of the Quran? The Quran. Now, and then the same is great-grandfather, forefather, Ahmed van Bengalen, and that link. Now the annals of history document this man is the imam of the Awal Masjid after Twanguru. Allahu Akbar. You never know. We do not want to be known. But if I humble myself in respect for the word of Allah and place it first, may Allah grant us all sincerity. But if I humble myself as far as Allah is concerned and His word is concerned and give it priority in my life, then Allah is the one to elevate. Man tawadha'a lillah, whosoever humbles himself for Allah and all that is associated with Him, Allah will grant elevation as He deems fit. Sometimes we make dua asking for certain things, but it might not be what is best for us. Allah knows what is best. That's why some unique dua as well is, Allah grant me what you know is better for me. But enough said, and I know it's was an off night for Bayu Mensa. What praat die man nou so lang? Terawih is klaar en die prater is klaar. But the reminders must continue, isn't it? And a reminder for myself too. We have the salah, inshallah, again, past 10. Yeah, 10 o'clock, quarter past 10. Inshallah. And the dua, Allahumma innaka afuun, must continue. Tuhibbul afwa, fa'afu anni, wa fa'afu anna. Wa Allah innaka afuun, verily you are most pardoning. Tuhibbul afwa, you love to pardon. فَعْفُ عَنِّي, so pardon me. Or فَعْفُ عَنَّا, so pardon us. Allahumma a'inna, O Allah, assist us. عَلَى ذِكْرِكَ, in your remembrance. Assist us to remember you, make it easy for us. It's tough out there with everything else being mentioned. Difficult to remember you. Assist us, help us to remember you. وَشُكْرِكَ, and help us to thank you. وحسن عبادتك, and help us to beautify your worship. And then Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, in Ramadan you must increase in two things. Increase in asking Allah for His pleasure and paradise, and increase in seeking protection from His displeasure and the fire. So, Allahumma inna nas'aluka ridaka wal jannah, wa na'udhu bika min sakhatika wal nar. Allahumma salli wa sallim wa barik ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. اللهم إنك عفو تحب العفو فاعف عنا. اللهم إنك عفو تحب العفو فاعف عنا. اللهم إنك عفو تحب العفو فاعف عنا. اللهم أعنا على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك. اللهم أعنا على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك. اللهم أعنا على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك. اللهم إنا نسألك رضاك والجنة ونعوذ بك من سخطك والنار. We pray for all our sick, Allah grant them relief. We pray for all our deceased, Allah increase the nur in the qubur. We pray for all those that have debts, Allah place barakah in their sustenance so they can settle their debts. All those with worries and concerns, Allah grant them relief from their worries and their concerns and the way out. We make dua for the ummah of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa sallallahu wa sallim wa barik ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'ina wa salamun ala al-mursaleen wa alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.